It's so important to put ourselves forward and to offer to do these things, to have our voice on that stage if we are underrepresented or kind of part of a marginalized group in a workplace, in an industry, at an event. We've got to, again, like I said, put ourselves forward or put someone else forward that is a diverse voice, is a voice that is not heard often, because it's so important for the audience in particular to see a role model. And it's just, it speaks volumes, I think, about your event. You know, if you are an organizer and you're not paying attention to the mix of who's on your stage, in, you know, this day and age, it's really inexcusable. And yet it happens all the time still.
Everyone has a diversity story, even those you don't expect. Welcome to The Will to Change with Jennifer Brown. Get ready to hear from leading CEOs, best-selling authors, and entrepreneurs as we uncover their true stories of diversity and inclusion. And now here's your host, Jennifer Brown. Hello and welcome to The Will to Change. This is Doug Foresta and Jennifer Brown. Today we are going to be discussing in this mini-stode, we're going to talk about taking the stage and the art of paneling. Jennifer, always great to be with you. Thanks so much.
Hey, thanks, Doug.
Thank you. So, yeah, let's talk about, first of all, before we're going to talk about paneling, you know, why being a panelist. But first, I guess the first thing I want to ask you is, why is it important, do you think, or is it important that we look for opportunities to, for example, be a panelist or to take the stage in some way?
Yes. Yes, my answer is that this is a great opportunity for any kind of visibility. So if you're asked to moderate a panel or be on a panel, those are both great roles that we can talk about today and how to manifest those. We also should be suggesting this kind of format. I really like the panel format. I know that a lot of people are amazed at how many I do. And also, you know, we have jokes that say like, oh, death by panel. You know, sometimes you go to a conference and it's like another panel, really? But you know, they really serve a great purpose. They get a lot of voices on the stage, and there can actually, in the best sense, there can end up being this great rapport between, unexpected rapport between people that have never met before often. And that really comes down, I think, to the not only the panelists, but the art of the moderator, of course. I mean, a really good moderator, you know, does the preparation we're going to talk about today and then creates the circumstances and the container for this amazing conversation to happen that's never happened before. So, you know, you've got different points of view. You've got different people that the audience can connect to as well. You know, somebody may really be struck by one particular panelist. And so the opportunity for learning across lots of different dimensions of who we are as learners is there as well when you're in the audience listening to a panel. So I think that the art of moderation, though, of panels is something I wanted to really delve into with you today, Doug, because I've done so much of it and I think about it a lot. I love the challenge of panels. They're complex and you never know where they're going. But to me, that's kind of part of the fun. And it's staying loose and responsive and listening and trying to, you know, stay on some kind of agenda. So it's sort of mental gymnastics, but in a good way.
Absolutely. So funny. Well, so one of the things I want to ask you before we get into, I think it's really cool to be able to get into this because you do a lot of panels and you're asked to do a lot of panels. But what has been possible for you or through moderating panels? Like you said, it's not about just doing it to do it. What kinds of opportunities have opened up for you through moderating panels?
Well, yeah, this is why I think it's such a great mechanism for leaders who are up and coming. So, you know, not all of us, probably almost none of us, are ready for the TED stage, right? That's something mm-hmm. that is very aspirational. And there's a lot of pressure that comes with being the only person on a stage. You know, right. It's very intimidating. So panels are this great way. It's like an interim warm up for you on the stage to get your voice, to find your footing, to state your point of view, to associate yourself with other leaders, which can be a very powerful thing in the audience's mind and powerful for your own brand. So just the fact that you get to be rubbing shoulders with and doing prep calls with some really big names and panels, panel participants usually are big names. That's usually why they're chosen. And usually the moderator's status is less, you know, in whatever metric you want to use. not a bad thing, you know, but moderators are often somebody that people don't know. And what's valued in a moderator is to facilitate the knowledge and the expertise of these people out and, you know, deliver that to the audience. That's your job. And your other job, I think, selfishly, is you're on that platform. You do have an opportunity as well, although it takes some skill, to make sure you're getting your point of view out here and there. But it's got to be done in a very subtle way, in a balanced way. And, you know, you've got to be looking for those moments to get your oar in, so to speak. But again, you know, we'll talk about that a little bit later. But it's a real art to do, to balance all of this at once. I think I would really recommend, though, you know, like I said earlier, this is an opportunity you always want to raise your hand for. You want to always say yes and figure out how you're going to do it later, which is some of the best advice I ever got. You know, don't let yourself ever be intimidated by an invitation to do moderating. You know, and today we'll talk through some of the things that I do in order to ground you in your preparation, to make sure you have enough questions to ask so that you always know kind of what am I doing next? Where am I taking the conversation next? You know, there are some real tactical things you can do to make sure like you're in charge of the flow, and you're ensuring everybody's getting heard and getting equal time, and that you're, you know, managing Q&A, and we can get into all the tactics of that in a bit. But, you know, how do you even chunk out the agenda? You know, how long do you need? All these questions, we can get into that. And I think through the preparation, I think you'll feel a lot better once you actually get on the stage.
I want to get into that in a minute, but before we do that, can you say a little bit about, you know, I guess this is a two-part question in a way. It's one question, but how do you get invited to do panels? But really, I have two. One is, how do you, Jennifer Brown, get invited to do panels? And then, you know, how does one get invited to do panels? Because you've been doing this for a while, so that,
it's true. It's
they may
true.
Not be the same answer.
Yeah, I mean, I it's funny. A lot of my corporate friends, right, who are employees and not entrepreneurs, they are putting themselves forward for like conferences, for example, or maybe somebody taps them on the shoulder to do something. Or, you know, in my case, I didn't have a company paying for me to go and moderate a panel. I mean, these are not paid opportunities usually. So when I was building my business, and this is advice for all entrepreneurs, we all are faced, I think, with opportunities to put ourselves forward or pitch a panel idea and pitch ourselves as moderators and put a panel together through our network, for example, and get on a plane and go and do this for free. And I am suggesting that you do this. I think it's really important from a marketing perspective. Whatever business you're in, you have to put yourself where your clients and your prospects are. Wherever they're gathering, you need to, it's sales 101. You need to be where they are. So, you know, for many years and still to this day, I will, to me, moderating a panel, something, one of the few things I'll do it for no fee, you know, because it isn't paid usually, but even bigger than that, it's, you know, I have met so many clients, you know, people who would end up being very important to my business that have been on like a single panel. I remember, you know, I've done a lot of work with Toyota and Genentech, over the years, and my contacts at Toyota and Genentech were on the same panel that I moderated once. So I walk in, I don't know them, I prepare, you know, we get to know each other, we're on the panel together, and they end up being fast friends and huge clients for us. And they were literally, we were talking about generational diversity on that particular panel, but I met them both at the same time. And so it's fortuitous, it's serendipitous. I think you can never know what's going to result. And I think we've all got to kind of hustle. We should all be thinking of ourselves as having some level of business development duties. You know, whether you're an employee and you get a paycheck every 2 weeks reliably, you know, I think we all need to be investing in our brand and making sure that we're rubbing shoulders with visible people, that we're, you know, we are gaining mentors and sponsors and broadening our network. So I think that these are really good ways to do that. But my advice would be not to get hung up on the investment of these things, because there's just so much that can happen that's serendipitous, that's unpredictable. And again, whatever kind of professional you are, whoever's paying your paycheck or not, you know, you've got to put yourself in these environments to, you know, you got to be there. Like, what do they say? Half of life is showing up.
Yeah, exactly. 99% of life is showing up. I
think it's, really? Yeah. And then doing a good job, which we'll talk about in a moment.
So let's talk about that doing a good job part. So I've decided to step forward. I'm going to take the stage. I'm going to be a moderator. What does that planning process look like? Where do I start? What do I do next?
Yeah. So sometimes I will pitch myself to moderate something and suggest panelists. One of the things that you want to do is do some work and give the whole package to someone that you're pitching, meaning you have a concept, you have a role for yourself, but you especially are bringing people to the table. That is doing somebody's work for them, making their lives easier and making it easier for them to say yes. So, you know, this is why, you know, we always need to be investing in our network. We need to have a broad Rolodex of experts. You know, you should always be doing that anyway. So do, you know, when you do get on somebody's radar screen, have all of that thought through. So you have a concept, you have the voices, you have a variety of whatever it is, industries, and remember, you know, diversity and inclusion wise, panels can fall into a big trap of not being diverse. So, you know, always bear in mind, if you have anything to do with the choice of panelists, you know, you're looking for a cross-section in every way, you know, sort of a multidimensional panel. It's really, really important. Or if you're on a panel, by the way, and you're noticing that it's not a diverse panel, it's really incumbent on us to question that. And to push back on the organizers if you're being asked to be a part of something, whether you're a panelist or a moderator. So back to, you know, how does it arrive in my lap? Sometimes it's something that I actually suggested. Somebody said yes, and now we need to prepare, right, and connect everybody, have conference calls. But other times I'm assigned a panel that I don't know. And then we have an introduction chain that goes back and forth over email. We have some prep calls. We get to know each other. You know, I introduce myself, my work, the point of view of the panel. Sometimes I'm given, it's interesting, sometimes somebody has mocked up the purpose of the panel and the talking points, and I receive it. And I don't think it's exactly as clean as it should be, or it doesn't make any sense, or it's, you know, I have an issue with the title that they want to use. It doesn't grab you, or maybe the title that they decided on doesn't reflect what I think the discussion should be about, or maybe doesn't reflect the expertise of the panelists, you know? So I sometimes have to really rewrite the title, the session description. And then when I'm coming up with the questions for the panelists, I have to come up with those as well. So sometimes you have to go into creative mode to reshape something that you inherit. And I would tell you, sometimes you have the authority to do that. So don't just assume because you're given something to do that you have to live with it as is. You know, your sense of having, you know, interviewed panelists and gotten to know them as part of the prep process, and this can be done with one-on-one calls or group calls. I mean, if you have the time, I think one-on-one calls with panelists is the best, because then you can really bond with them. You can get a feel for who they are.
Sure.
You can, you know, ask them questions like, what do you really want to talk about vis-a-vis this topic? You know, what's really important to you? What are you really proud of? And we can go into some other questions in a moment, Doug. But I think that your ability, when you're asked to moderate something, don't just assume you're inheriting something that you can't do anything about. You know, this happened to me recently, and it arrived on my desk, and it's this huge panel in front of 7,000 people, but I thought it was really poorly written, like poorly titled. The questions were all over the place that the organizing team had given me. And then I looked at the panelists and I thought about their background and what I think, you know, they probably want to talk about given what they do and who they are. And it just was all out of whack. So, you know, I asked if I could revise it. And they said, oh my goodness, yes, we would love it if you would. We really don't know what we're doing here.
So they were actually very receptive.
They were.
So they were
great. They were grateful. Yeah. And what you have to know about conferences is there's like a core, very small, inexperienced team usually managing the agenda, So they are stretched super thin. And yes, they have to, they basically own this multi-day agenda with thousands of people, with multiple stages and breakouts and main stage. And, you know, it is really complicated. So I think that usually my experience is organizing teams are very responsive to you taking the wheel and kind of steering things. So ask these questions, you know, don't let it pass by. And it's your opportunity, by the way, to put your stamp on something. You know, right. It's your opportunity also to drive the conversation to where you want to drive it and what energizes you, which is going to make you a better moderator and better on stage anyway, because you're going to be talking about what you want to talk about and what you think is most intriguing about the topic and about the leaders that you have now met and whose stories it's your job to facilitate out of them and give it to the audience, which is your job. So, you know, you have to be excited. You have to think this is an important discussion. And ultimately, you're really there to enable these people to shine. Well, you know, that's your job.
Well, I have a follow-up question to that, which is that idea that, you know, yes, as it's your job to help these people to shine. At the same time, is it ever okay to have or bring a point of view with you as a moderator?
Yeah, I think it's a real fallacy that a moderator is just a vessel. Yeah, and this is where my business development hat comes in as a business owner, always trying to think about, you know, what's in it for me to be on this stage? You know, I was talking about earlier, getting yourself on a plane and doing things without being paid and doing all the prep work, which, by the way, sometimes panelists are really kind of itchy and they want a lot of prep calls, you know.
Right, right.
And it's, you know, it's a little bit annoying for me.
It's not an insignificant amount of time.
No, it's not. And if you take on rewriting the session description and coming up with a different title and sending people the questions that you agree to, and even going so far as what I do, which is letting them react to the questions and sending me their favorite questions. You know, there's a lot of back and forth. I mean, I go on stage for panels sometimes and I have like 10 pages of notes and I'm ready to do something in 45 minutes with four people. That I've thought about how I'm going to structure it, how much time, you know. So anyway, it's a little complex. I mean, I don't mean to intimidate our listeners, because I my overall message is say yes to things right. like this, you know. And right. What's the worst that can happen? but yes, Doug, I think that what's in it for you as a moderator, you know, you have these precious moments on the stage to be seen by hundreds of people, or maybe thousands in some of my cases. So I am there to be in service of the people and often the companies they represent, right? So getting those stories out there and their personal stories. But I'm also there to connect the dots in the way that I can only do, because I'm an expert in this topic. And sometimes you're not an expert, by the way, in what you're moderating. So that presents its own challenges. And if we have time, maybe we could talk about that too, Doug, because I've certainly been there. But if you do know the topic fairly well, you should, for example, the mechanics of it are to invite the voices on your panel to weigh into certain questions. And then when they finish speaking, everyone kind of turns back to you as a moderator and the ball's in your court again. And I think at that moment, before you redirect and you throw the ball to somebody else on the panel, mm-hmm. you have an opportunity to say, you know what, you know, Jane, the point you just made really resonates with me. What we see in my work is that this is how that shows up, or this is what I would add to what you just shared that I think might be helpful for our audience. So you're actually engaging with your panelists and reacting to and adding to what they've said, but you're also adding value to the point that was just made, and you're involving the audience, but you're all of a sudden kind of talking to the audience for a moment as well. So it always feels to me like that's how I kind of subtly get my points in, as I add to a point that was made. I kind of turn my shoulders to the audience and I almost become a panelist for a moment, because a moderator is a panelist also. You're also a teacher. You know, you have points that you can make that are additive, that can connect the dots between what is said on that stage. And you're not just there to reflect. You're there to reflect, and I would say curate and highlight what is most important about what is being said on that panel for the audience. So this is why I always need to know who the audience is so that I can know. And this is part of the preparation, particularly with the organizers of a conference. They know their audience best, right? They've run this, you know, conference probably for years. Your questions really are, as a moderator, you know, has there been a panel on this before? You know, what level is this audience? How much are they going to know about this topic? Does it need to be a basic conversation or can it be an advanced conversation? Are these, what other questions you might want to ask are, has this topic been broached in the past? What has been people's feedback about it? What do you think they struggle with when it comes to this topic? You know, a lot of conference organizers are always polling their audiences year over year to say, you know, what are your, if it's a women's conference, for example, what are your unique challenges? What are you still struggling with? You know, all that information enables you as a moderator to steer the conversation to a place that's valuable for the audience. And you really should be armed with that information when you step on stage so that you can have that in mind as a lens or a filter as you're soliciting these stories from your panel so that you can, you know, translate it to the audience. So, you know, this is why, I know I don't mean to overwhelm, because the moderator, this is why this role is difficult and really, I think, in a wonderful way, challenging, because you're sort of having multiple agendas going on. You have your own agenda. You're thinking about the audience and what they need to learn. And you're also thinking about, like, what are the panelists, how do I enable them to tell the best story, for example, that they shared in the prep call? How do I tee that up for them? How do I make sure that they have the opportunity and I open the door so that they can share that one story that they're the proudest of, you know, in terms of their professional accomplishments. So I'm always kind of thinking about these things, and it's a challenge, because as they're answering a question that you might ask, meanwhile, you're sort of preparing for where you're going to take the group next. So, it's kind of a weird thing, but as soon as I ask a question and a panelist starts to answer, I'm sort of back into my notes thinking about, okay, so this person's answering this. Where is it going to go next? Who have I not heard from on the panel in a while? You know, whose story relates to the point that's being made now that I can then invite next? So I'm kind of go back in and think, you know, I'm there, but I'm not there. And I'm thinking, you know, where am I going to take this next? Because that's the other thing. Directionally, panels can go a lot of different places, you know, depending on the energy and the things that are said. So best laid plans. I think the worst panels are the ones that don't breathe. You know, they're the ones that are clearly somebody is kind of working through their list of questions in order, and it's kind of the mechanics of it. Like, you can see how the sausage is being made. I don't think those rise to the level of an art form. But if you're a beginning moderator, it's completely fine to do it that way. Just know that there's an aspiration for you to get to the point where you've got your questions, you did your prep, and in a way you could even, somebody could just grab your notes and like throw them away. you just need to be present, you know, and let your curiosity guide you, let your sense and intuition guide you, you know, see where the panelists want to go and literally kind of, you know, ride the wave of it. And that is kind of, to me, the higher form of, you know, you did your preparation, you've got some key concepts in mind, but ultimately you throw your notes away, you go where the group wants to go, you let your curiosity guide you, and you kind of have a sense for, you know, where the audience is responding, reacting, laughing. You know, you can kind of at some point feel the attention of the audience. You know, you can tell if something's really silent in a good way, people are like really listening. If it's silent in sort of a multitasking sort of way,
right.
And you're like, I better step this up really fast.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Anyway, so
you know what's an interesting one about that? Just really quick, that I learned this from my theater days. If people are touching their face, that's a really good sign.
Oh, no kidding.
We touch our face when we're emotional, and so, ooh, if you watch Disney movies, you always see people touching their face a lot, like if you watch the audience. So if people are touching their face, that's always a good sign. I just throw that in there.
And not their device. That's good.
And not their device. Exactly. I want to ask you, we have to kind of wrap it up in a few, but I wanted to ask you, since you wrote the book on inclusion, I want to make sure, I mean, you've talked a little bit about this, but I want to ask you the question directly, which is, what does inclusion look like on a panel?
Yeah, it's panels are one of those things that Twitter is always is going crazy over. Who's selected for panels? Who gets time on stage? Who doesn't? The gender in particular, and then I'd say the ethnicity as well of panels and moderators. And this is why I think, going back to how we began this episode, Doug, that it's so important to put ourselves forward and to offer to do these things, to have our voice on that stage, particularly if we are underrepresented or kind of part of a marginalized group in a workplace, in an industry, at an event. So we've got to, again, like I said, put ourselves forward or put someone else forward that is a diverse voice, is a voice that is not heard often, because it's so important for the audience in particular to see a role model. And it speaks volumes, I think, about your event. You know, if you are an organizer and you're not paying attention to the mix of who's on your stage, in, you know, this day and age, it's really inexcusable. And yet it happens all the time still. And that's why on Twitter, you'll see something blow up, you know, and a speaker agenda will be announced at a tech conference and everybody will just go nuts because there's like no women on a panel that is allegedly about the Me Too movement and gender parity. You know, this stuff still happens. So I think be a part of that change. You know, if you're the organizer, notice it. If you're on a panel, notice it. If you're being invited, or if, you know, if you think you'd be a great panelist, make sure that you get your voice heard, particularly if you are not represented in a conversation. I think people would be really grateful for it. I think the complaint of, oh, we can't find any diverse panelists, we can't find, you know, any women that are experts on XYZ. You know, we've got to all be part of removing that alleged obstacle. And I say alleged because we all know it's not true. Right. The reason that people can't, you know, a woman expert in VR, for example, can't be found is only because your network is limited, you know, and right. You're hanging out with people that look like you. It's the only reason. I mean, they're out there. And one underrepresented panelist, I think in my experience, knows many more. So there's like, if you tap into a vein of these kinds of voices, you'll find that these voices know other voices. You know, my network's going to be maybe more female and maybe more women of color, because it is who I'm looking for. It's who I'm paying attention to. So if you access me, you access all sorts of people in my network. So I think that organizers, it's a failure of networks, failure of imagination, failure of being persistent, honestly, and looking beyond the obvious choices. And also remember, you know, for every woman that's listening to this, there are 10 men that are probably putting themselves forward for things that you're not putting yourself forward for. Like, you've got to know that's happening. And for every person of color that's listening to this, you know, there's a white colleague who's like, of course I'll be on that. Or, yeah, I'm going to ask my friend to be on that panel with me. You know, you've got to know that's what's happening. So we have to interrupt that. And we need to be interrupters if we have a platform for making these choices. And, you know, and if you're a man who's being asked to be on a panel, one of the big ally behaviors that you can exhibit is questioning whether you are the right voice to be on a panel. Like, do you need that visibility? Could someone else appreciate that visibility? And it would be good for the audience to see someone in your stead. And that's, you know, it feels a little like sacrificing your spot, but I do think that the question might be, you've been on 25 panels this year. Do you really need to
be
on another one?
Right, exactly. Yeah. Is that 26 going to put you over the top?
Or, you know, do you need to moderate? You know, I don't know. Unless you are, I would give you a pass if you were like, okay, I'm going to moderate this panel, but I'm going to totally switch up who the panel is. Like, I'm going to diversify that. and I'm going to bring in, you know, I might be a white guy moderator and I'm going to bring in all women of color on this tech panel, you know, and that's my commitment and I'm going to go find them. And by the way, you end up bonding with people that you do panels with. It's, I cannot tell you, it's broadened my network enormously to put out a call on Twitter and say, you know, I'm looking for, I don't know, women of color, technologists in XYZ field, because like that's the conference that I've been invited to moderate at, and just getting like so many amazing people coming through that I never knew. So these are great, great networking tools, but you've got to beg, you've got to ask the question, you know, who is not represented here? How can I be part of diversifying that? Whether you end up on that panel or not, whether you end up moderating, to me is kind of less important. Because I think the bigger good is to be a champion for inclusion means, you know, whatever your role is or is not selfishly, you are ensuring that diverse voices are getting on the stage. That is paramount. So that's a big call out for me. The other thing that I do, Doug, is to be inclusive. It was really interesting. I did a panel at the Forum for Workplace Inclusion in Minneapolis in February, March of this past year. And 2/3 of my panel were blind professionals. And it was just incredible to partner with them in terms of how I would moderate. It made me realize we take so much for granted about how and when, for example, we actually physically get on the stage, and how the cues that we give that are visual as moderators, for example, gesturing to someone to indicate that it's their turn to speak, you know, it challenged me to communicate to, you know, Kathy Martinez, who was one of my panelists from Wells Fargo, who's a dear friend and who was a previous guest on The Will to Change. You know, indicating to her verbally that I was, you know, I was teeing her up for, you know, a question, and being cognizant of the language that we use. So sometimes, you know, in the disability space, inclusion on a panel is going to take some overt behaviors and calibration with your panelists that took it to a whole different level for me to make sure that, you know, everybody's voice was heard, that I was, you know, again, bringing out their best and enabling them to be comfortable on this stage. And they, you know, it's interesting to tune into how they were sensing the audience and each other when you're sight impaired, feeling the energy of the audience and responding to other panelists and the whole, it was fascinating. It was like a whole different learning opportunity for me to be of service in that particular context. So I do think, you know, as we're being inclusive with panels, we ask the question of each panelist, you know, how can I make your experience most successful? And, you know, inviting that question that then somebody can offer, you know, I'm a little hard of hearing, for example. So here's something that I need. Similarly, I think being inclusive means asking people, you know, what question would you like most to be asked? You know, what would you like to offer versus kind of me being too overly directive about the agenda and the questions? So I think that's an inclusion tactic. And then most of all, making sure that people have equal airtime. I've seen this happen even on panels of women. I've seen this happen where one particular female panelist would just take over.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, it is your job as a moderator to balance the voices and to make sure you are redirecting someone who's talking too much. You are inviting somebody who's not talking enough to intentionally share. And so you're always directing traffic with inclusion in mind. And I do that. I'm kind of thinking about, again, another lens to add. It's like, are we getting through the questions we need to get to, but are we hearing from everybody equally? And that can be tricky because it means you have to cut some people off. It means that you have to, you know, invite others to jump in and weigh in. But I find that all people need is an invitation to share, you know, that then they will do the rest of the work for you. But you're going to have quieter voices on panels. You just are. And I think it's your job as a moderator to ensure it's a good experience for everyone and that nobody feels they got, you know, too much airtime, too little airtime. And one final thing, Doug, I know we've got to go, but the Q&A process, it could be its own mini-sode in and of itself. But there's some really great technology out there that, again, is very inclusive. Passing the mic in a big room is you know, you're going to hear from the loudest, most confident voices. But I really love these technologies like Slido, for example, is one that comes to mind, where people can text in their questions. And you as a moderator or working with someone who's in the front row and sort of teeing questions up to you that are coming through the virtual network, people can vote up and down different questions that come in over the text. And you can get some of those questions that the audience wants to know, but that maybe, you know, somebody didn't feel confident enough, you know, raising their hand and grabbing the microphone or walking to the aisle and, you know, sidling up to the mic. So I really recommend I think it's an inclusive practice to utilize some of these text-driven Q&A vehicles. And then you as a moderator get to add that on an iPad in front of you, or again, have somebody from the audience stand up and say, Jennifer, we have a question from the audience that got a lot of likes. And so, you know, I wanted to give that to you and then have you respond and you turn to the panel and get their responses, weigh in, et cetera. So I do think inclusion can be practiced as well through the utilization of some of these technologies that are coming out. And I'm really grateful for that because it's very cool to be able to hear the audience and hear what's on their minds and not just have the loudest or most confident speaker kind of belly up to the mic and get their question answered.
Right. As we've all been to those.
We all know those audience members.
Yes, exactly. Jennifer, this has been amazing. I think what's great about it is such a combination of inspiration, of really inspiring diverse voices to step up to the stage, and then the practical aspect of here's how we do it. So thank you so much for sharing, you know, both that inspiration piece and also your lived experience of how to do this.
Sure thing, Doug. I hope to hear a lot more voices from our audience up on the stage. So let's go.
Exactly. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Hi, this is Jennifer. Did you know that we offer a full transcript of every podcast episode on my website over at jenniferbrownspeaks.com? You can also subscribe so that you get notified every time a new episode goes live. Head over there now to read my latest thoughts on diversity, inclusion, and the future of work, and discover how we can all be champions of change by bringing our collective voices together and standing up for ourselves and each other.
You've been listening to The Will to Change, Uncovering True Stories of Diversity and Inclusion with Jennifer Brown. If you've enjoyed the episode, please subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. To learn more about Jennifer Brown, visit jenniferbrownspeaks.com. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back next time with a new episode.